Central Visayas and welcome to our 26th episode sa aming BLGF Kapihan. Yan. Ikonsulta mo kay Atty. Tanyeka. Good morning entire Philippines as well kasi may suki tayo from the entire nation, Luzon, Visayas and Mindanao. Yan. Bago natin papasadahan yung ating top news of the week, puntahan agad natin yung ating regional director for the message sa ating pang 26 na kapihan. Lately, nagiging busy itong RD natin. He has been fixing things, going out to LGUs and saying to it that our personnel on the field, yung mga treasurer at assessor natin, are in the good position of responding to their duties and functions amidst the pandemic. RD, good morning RD, pasok!
Thank you, boys. Good morning, Pilipinas. Maayong buntag, Central Visayas. Tabi na sa itong mga treasurer and, treasurers and assessors. So, welcome to our 26th episode. This is part 2. Hindi na natin natapos pag-take up yung discussion ni Attorney Tanyeka last episode. So, medyo interesting yung topic. So, kaya lang medyo ang reklamo ng mga treasurers and assessors natin. If we have done it physically, maraming learning experience sana. Kasi they have a lot of inputs, insights sa topic na present po ni Attorney Tanyeka. So that is why, despite the ifs and buts, so we are still here. We want to create effective learning experiences through our virtual environment. So with our social distancing now as the norm, we must feel all we must all find new innovative ways to carry on our work, even though we cannot be together in the same room, but we are here. Okay? We are here. We have Attorney Tanyeka, and we have the online Kapihan sa BLGF7 as our virtual learning. Okay? Although there remains a deep and understandable concern that virtual formats may not be sufficient for all learning experiences. Okay? So, sabi ko nga, reklamo ng mga treasurers and assessors natin, how we can engage workshop participants effectively when hindi nila nakikita yung mga participants. Okay? How our treasurers and assessors become accountable, okay, for their learning and successfully drive behavior, especially in virtual environment. Okay? And crucial of it all is paano natin mamimaintain an impact and momentum of learning programs that were designed to be delivered face-to-face. So I understand si Attorney Tanyeka, should this topic been discussed physically? Alam ko maraming questions, maraming tanong, maraming Q&A on that matter. That is why we are posing these questions to all of you. Paano ba natin, how to drive engagement, accountability, action in a virtual learning environment? This is in relation to the topic of Attorney Tanyeka, which is responsibility, liability, and accountability. So we want you to be engaged, especially in the Kapihan. We are here to motivate, invite you to join the Kapihan, although we understand that there are participants, okay? Because our participants are prone to distraction, okay? They just open their Facebook or the Kapihan. Then there are a lot of distraction, okay, in front of their computer. Halimbawa, merong mga emails, social media alerts, news update, and so on and so forth. So meron ding engagement, okay, levels are less visible kasi hindi naman namin alam sino yung mga tumitingin sa amin. So that is why in Kapihan, we deem it apply our virtual accountability model. So we call this a three triangular model. Okay, we have verbal accountability, visual accountability, and kinesthetic accountability. Ano ba yung verbal? So ito yung we want to engage, we want to maintain high levels of engagement. Okay? So that is why Attorney Tanyeka really would like our viewers to speak up, okay, what they need to help, what help they needed, or ano pa yung further this explanation, discussion na gusto nyo, okay? Especially that they would be in a live setting. Okay, so we want you to be verbally accountable. Okay? Aside from that, the virtual environment has a wide range of virtual possibilities, varying layouts and using rich content such as videos, diagrams, and charts can help increase visual accountability. So we're so grateful that napakagaling po ng production team namin. They offer, okay, their uses very innovative, okay, in presenting a rich content, videos, diagrams, and a lot more. And in fact, last week of this month, so our production team will be really doing a field work for this matter. And finally, yung kinesthetic accountability. So we understand that the real problem when it comes to effective virtual learning is that we want to create another many opportunities for interaction as possible. So that is why si Attorney nag-call na for chat, comment, commentaries on our chat box. Meron din siyang in-offer na, binigay na yung cellphone number namin. Na you can, ano yung tawag, Torrance, yung phone patch up for an interview. So all this yields to help you to increase kinesthetic accountability. So with that, this platform is really geared of reaching out our treasurers and assessors. Wala po kaming intention or to fill in the gap, especially at this time of pandemic. So we're thankful enough that we have a very, very good and napaka guwapo na host, Attorney Tanika, that he is sparing his time for this online kapihan sa BLGF. So thank you so much, Lord. So we want our viewers to be engaged, to help, to speak out what you have in mind, because we do not know sino yung mga nakaka-engage, sino yung nakikinig, sino yung mga nabinipisyuhan ng services ng online kapihan. So we need your feedback. Please comment down if you're viewing or meron kayong natutunan. Please, it would be a good feedback for all of us. Thank you, Torrance, and good morning.
Thank you, Adi. Good morning, Adi. We want you to engage with us in this online platform. When this idea started, why do we have this online kapihan? Ito ang anniversary message sana namin ng aming kapihan. Yan. You know, si RD kasi na-observe niya ang dami pa rin needs of yung parang guidance from the field sa baba. So pumupunta sa office, nagpapa-guidance, nagtatanong na ganito yung paano, how do we proceed from this and that. So nakita ni RD, everybody can learn from this sharing of experiences, sharing of knowledge. So sabi ni RD, wag tayong mag-mute. Instead of isa lang yung makarinig sa ating opinion, sabi ni RD, why won't you put people up? Online kapihan sa BLGF7. And incidentally, hindi lang Central Visayas yung nakikinig, ang entire Philippines. And with that, we have the RD Dr. Lero to thank for having this initiative of opening up to all, reaching up to all the local treasury and assessment services, hindi lang dito sa Central Visayas. Ang sabi ni RD, comment ang comment niya, ang hirap kaya mag-lecture, mag-discuss through online platform. Kung mahirap kayong makinig or to focus on what we are talking in here, mas mahirap mag-engage sa inyo kasi hindi namin alam where we won't jump off. So kaya it would help if you will comment right now. So comment, ayan. We will divide this again. We will have ikonsulta, dalawang ikonsulta ngayon. Isa application, continuation of our responsibility, accountability, and liability. At sa mga update natin, nakita nyo sa Facebook page namin, busy yung naming regional director, kapunta sa mga local treasury and assessment offices, mga courtesy call na rin ng aming mga municipal mayor dito sa Cebu. In the meantime, we will be remiss if we will not pasadahan natin itong mga news that matters for the week that was. Huwag na natin top news of the week. Kasi top news kasi yung isang news na may tatakbo daw presidente instead of man. So ito na lang mga news that matters. First, ito na yung kinakatatukan. Sorry for that. Ito muna yung declaration ITF through the approval of our president. Metro Manila, yung NCR plus Bulacan, Cavite, Laguna, Rizal, under na ng general community quarantine. However, mayroong heightened restriction. Yun, yung mga padalhin, 30% ng capacity lang. Bawal pa rin yung mga entertainment venues, yung mga recreational venues, yung mga venues for meeting and conferences and exhibitions. So, bawal pa rin doon sa GCQ with heightened restriction. Pangalawang news that matters of the week, ayan, nakapasok na yung Indian variant dito sa Philippines. And as according to Yusek Berheri, they have initially detected 2 travelers from India that were tested positive for the highly infectious disease. Ngayon, 12 na yata or 10. So, kasi contact tracing. Ayan, nakapasok na si COVID variant ng India. And epidemiologist John Wong, on the presence of India variant, sabi niya, this is a threat to the public health, so we need to be careful and do things as from the start. Be very careful din, kasi you know what happened to India. And infectious disease expert Dr. Solandi cites the people's behavior in crowding over area that could also accelerate the problem with the COVID positivity rate. Pangalawang news that matters. Yan, sabi ni PRRD, President Rodrigo Roa Duterte, sabi niya, you forgo fiesta muna. May kasi ngayon, ang daming fiesta, lalo dyan sa Bohol. Shout out sa mga Boholanos, good morning. Sabi ng ating President, not centering or not citing any particular region or any particular LGU or province. Sabi ni President Duterte, you forgo fiesta muna. Celebration, be mindful, sabi ni President, because we are still in a pandemic and there is no way of knowing how long this would last. So ang hinihingi ko, sabi ng presidente, is not only to tone down fiesta celebration, but to forgo. Wala mo ng fiesta, sayang. So, ang daming nagfiesta ngayon. At ito, pangatlong news that matters for the week. Through Presidential Declaration Number 1143, on May 10, the President has placed the entire country under the state of calamity due to African swine flu outbreak. Nahihirapan ng yung mga hog raisers natin. Pang-apat na news of the week, bago tayo maubusan ng oras, mainit at maalinsang ang panahon, patuloy-tuloy daw yan na maranasan sa buong bansa dulot ng estrus. And in fact, PAGASA even recorded a dangerous heat index of 52 degrees in Dagupan City. So yung mga nasa labas, stay hydrated. Sumilong naman kayo. Delikado sa heat stroke yung mainit na yung malansangan. Ayan. At saka last, ito news that matters ba ito? Ano ba itong production team? Palaging may mga news item about showbiz. Ayan, idol kasi ni Sergio Lispano ito. Si Sergio Lloyd, ha? Kilala niyo si Sergio Lloyd? Kilala niyo siguro si Elena Dana. At saka si Derek Ramsey. Hindi natin pag-usapan. Si John Lloyd daw is definitely making a showbiz comeback. Ayan, news that matter yan. Ayan, before we go. Ayan, Arde, balik na yung idol mo, Arde, sa John Lloyd.
Turns on the lighter note, marami kasing nagtatanong sa akin, sa ano ba yung secret ko? Bakit hindi ako nawawala ng energy in visiting all the LGUs? So ganito, ito lang yung secret ko. I just would like to share it with our viewers. Ito lang yung Loy Ati. Ito yung ano, para hindi, lalo pat kung malapit ka ng ubuhin, para hindi ka aalisan ng mga kausap mo. So ito lang yung Loy Ati made o ang product ano, RNC Marketing, yung may-ari si former Vice Mayor Ray Caloy.
Vice Mayor,
yes.
Vice Mayor Ray Caloy.
Southern Leyte. Okay? And shout out in turn so yung ano, yung Cebuano Business Club, a group of micro and small entrepreneurs are watching us. So thank you for joining Kapihan, and they are more than willing, should our Kapihan need to be ano daw ko no may mga topics about entrepreneur, mga small time. We are more than willing to share their stories.
Yeah, our... hindi ba matapang yung organic mo? Masarap pa siya yung hagod niya.
Ay, napaka ano Torres, very very light tapos
ano yan, Adi, Louis A?
Ano dito
sa pangalan niya?
Yes, Louis A. Master Louis A.
Master Louis A, yan.
Yes.
Makabilingan yan. Hanapin ko yan sa mga grocery stores. Yan, maganda yung hagod, sabi ni RD. Organic pa naman. Okay, at this juncture, siguro ang dami nang nanood sa atin sa online streaming live dyan sa ating Facebook page. Pasadahan agad-agad natin kasi we will limit as much as possible this episode to 1 hour only. Pasadahan natin yung mga shoutout, sigaw, labas at pa-comments dyan. Pasok, Miss Juna Nabilia.
Hello, magandang umaga po sa lahat ng mga nanonood.
Welcome yun, po sa 26. Nanuno, sa punsoy ka na tuloy.
26 tuloy. Episode ng Kapihan sa BLGF, Kapihan BLGF 7. Welcome sa ating masaya at mabalitaktakan na Lunes po sa ating lahat from Luzon, Visayas at Mindanao. So, bago po tayo mag-shout out, gusto ko lang po munang batiin itong mga mayors na mga friends ni RD. Ha, si Mayor ng Alcantara, si Attorney Fritz A. Lastimoso.
Mayor, morning,
Mayor ng Alegria, si Mayor Verna A. Magallion. Ang Mayor ng Badyan, si Mayor Carmencita Lumain. At ang Mayor ng Mualbual, si Mayor Paz A. Rusguni.
Ay, balita ko sa Mualbual, may magandang lugar daw diyang mapunta. Eh, during this time of pandemic, we need to relax, to de-stress.
Of course, attorney, 'di ba? Sabi mo kanina, medyo mainit na ang panahon, summer na. So kailangan din nating mag-relax. So if you gusto niyo mag-relax, punta lang kayo sa Mualbual. May i-recommend ako na resort, place na kung saan pag malapad siya at saka kung iwas COVID din dahil napaka
How's the place na? I heard magandang diving spot daw yung Mualbual. Pwede bang mag-dive doon na?
Of course, Mualbual is sinasabi na the best diving spot, sabi ng mga foreigners. Kasi may makikita niyo doon yung sardines run at saka ang linis-linis ng ano nila ng
ayoko dagat. Ayoko mapunta ng miss saan doon sa Mualbual. Ano yung lugar na puntahan mo? Mapuntahan na yan?
Ay, attorney, may i-recommend ko sa iyo itong Cubadis. Alam mo?
Cubadis.
Cubadis ang pangalan ng
How is that spelled? Cubadis. No, Cubadis.
Cubadis. Ang meaning daw nito is where are you going? Wow. Cubadis. Oh. So Sasa you're going to Mualbual for Cubadis. Answer yan ng where are you going. So shout out muna po para kay Aileen Colo Flores Parado ng Consolacion Cebu. Kay Richie Gungob ng Consolacion, Ernesto Rupa.
Nay, wait muna Nay, may sabihin si Ardi, napunta rin yata siya sa Cubadis. Ardi, madidistress ka ba doon sa Cubadis? Ang yes, talaga yung ambience.
I'm so glad that Governor Garcia has opened the economy, especially sa yung tourism industry, where yung Mualbual, most of our towns na we visited, they're reliant on the tourism, especially tourism. Yung Mualbual. And good to know that Governor Garcia is opening now the economy. And I'm so amazed with the experience in Mualbual tours because wala kang makitang basura sa seashore. Sabi ko, napaka, and it's the people, the beach owner, the motorboat owner are doing cleanliness every week. They have, yung iba, 1 year lang sila nag yung sila pala all year round ginagawa nila. Sabi ko, I haven't seen any single basura in Mualbual. Napakalinis. So true to their, you will really be amazed if you visit the place. Particularly yung Cubadis.
Cubadis.
Yung nag-host sa amin na, yung pinuntahan namin na hotel.
Nay, masarap ba yung pagkain doon sa Cubadis, Nay? Mukhang nasarapan ka doon?
Masasarapan talaga kayo dahil ang daming-daming choices ng mga pagkain from mula sa Basta may recommend ko lang sa inyo, no, yung baby back ribs. Ang sarap-sarap noon.
Try nyo na. Kaba daw yung food doon kasi yun yung parating inapang ng mga viewers natin, yung mga secret mo. So, nakakabata ba daw yung food doon?
ang para sa akin na nakakabata sa akin itong kape na to.
Ha? Ayan, kape na
attorney,
naman. Kapihan
gusto mo rin ng kape? Oh, this is kape ng Kapinoy.
Mm-hmm. Paborito ko pa naman yung cappuccino na eh. Sarap ba siya? Na yung para may tsokolate na mix sa kape. Eh, ang ganda ng mixture. So, sarap ba siya? Na?
Oh, gusto mo sa attorney, padalhan kita ngayon din ng cappuccino.
Ay, baka naman.
Ipa-food panda ko, ha? Antayin mo lang. Oh, darating
ano
na.
Ano nga yan? Kapinoy, cappuccino.
Kapinoy, ayan. Kapinoy, cappuccino flavor. Ang dami din flavor nito, mabibili ito sa ano, sa mga
department. Available ba yan sa market, Junan?
Opo, sir. Available ito sa
ay, makabili, ano,
mga groceries.
Tama.
Pwede kayong Kapinoy.
Bumili. So, yun ang secret mo. Bakit bumabaka ka? Kahit napakarami.
Siguro.
Dahil, opo, dahil siguro. Sa kaping ng kape Pinoy. Ito lang ang nagpapa, itong sikreto ko.
Boy, kaya kayo yung gusto nyo bumata, ininom din kayo.
At saka yung Luya mo, sir.
yung Luya ni Ardik, saglit lang yung Kapinoy mo, ha? Sobrang-sobra na yung exposure, na. balik sa Luya mo, Ardik. Para tabla, oh. Ano yun, ha? Masters Luya, ayan. So, balik sa mga pa-shoutout, Nay, para hindi magtampo yung mga viewers. Go ahead.
Isang sigaw palabas para kay Marilo Herrera ng Consolation Cebu, kay Brenda Liamedo, kay Ana Teresa Balani, kay Ronnie Biriol, kay Annabel Enriquez, kay Tita Barcina Ruiz, kay Ed Rosas. Isang sigaw palabas pa rin kay Sid Cardente Caballero at saka kay Edwin Villanueva. Torrance, balik muna sa iyo.
Thank you. Ayan, sabihin ko sana ang I love you. Ano yan? I love you, Kapinoy. Ayan. Thank you po sa masarap na kape na pinatikim nyo sa amin at saka yung organic Luya. Good morning, Mayor Paso Mualboal. Sarap daw doon sa Kovadix. And I will promise to you, I will not hold you long. Sabi nga ni Ardi, ang hirap mag-deliver ng ganitong deliverables online platform pag walang focus yung ating audience. So, one of the factor na makakawala ng focus is yung long time. So, siguro magkakaroon tayo ng third or fourth episode nito, but just to go slowly lang sa accountability, responsibility, and liability. For today, I will just deliver one case study para lang hindi masyadong mahaba yung ating episode. Production team, let me have the screen na. Ayan. Do I have the screen now, production team? Yeah? Oh, nakikita na ba? Okay. Isang recap lamang doon sa anong nangyayari natin last week. As we said, napapanahon sana itong topic na ito during election time. Kasi dito yun pinapawisan ng malamig yung mga treasurer natin. Ang daming kaso daw kasi pag election time. We just making light of the situation, ha? Na hindi natin kinukutya pero talagang ganun. Napapasabak yung mga treasurers at assessors minsan sa during election time. Okay. As a recap, sabi natin, we distinguish responsibility from accountability. Hindi po yan pare-pareho. At saka kung ma-identify man natin ang yung isang officer, a responsible officer, at saka accountable officer, hindi automatic liable. May measures of liability kasi. Another thing also is that liability does not equate to administrative liability. It's just a pecuniary liability to refund, to reimburse nga, sabi natin. So, yung sa administrative liability, kailangan pa kasing dumaan ng due process. So, madaling pasada, the term responsible, yeah, di ba? Responsible officer, being answerable to discharge the duty. Ito yung sabi ni ng Liberty Commissioner Rosal, ng Commissioner Audit. Responsibility, therefore, you have to exercise, you have the obligation to exercise the assigned authority. Yung authority mo is supervision. responsible officer ka, ibig sabihin mayroong subordinate ka to supervise them through diligence of a good father of a family. So sino yung mga sinusupervise mo? Minsan, or karamihan, yung mga sinusupervise mo are accountable officers. Ano muna, ano naman itong accountable officers? Mamaya, tingnan natin. Sabi dito, under the law, the heads of government agencies are usually the responsible officers and should see to it that funds and properties are expended and utilized in accordance with the law and regulation. Ayan nga, sabi na nga, supervision. So, mainly, the obligation of this responsible officer is to supervise. Diligence of a good father of family to see to it yung mga subordinate niya are acting within the bounds of the law and to safeguard against loss or wastage through illegal or improper disposition. So sa local government code, ito yung responsibility of a treasurer. First, of course, solidary, emergency, and primary responsible for government funds and property under his custody. Siya yung responsible for government funds and property under his custody. Pangalawa, he is responsible. Ay, biglang nag-move si cursor ko. He is responsible over local treasury personnel directly entrusted under his supervision. The personnel which are entrusted with the custody or possession of funds. So punta naman tayo sa accountability. Sabi natin, responsibility is supervision, diligence of a good father of family, di ba? To see to it yung mga accountable persons under you are performing in accordance with the law. Ano ba naman yung accountable officers? So, primarily accountable officers are those whose duties, yung trabaho nila, require them or permits them to possess or take custody of government funds or property. So, napaka-simple lang. Pag si responsible officer, kailangang supervision, responsible, answerable siya doon sa subordinates. Si accountable, yung merong actual possession at saka custody ng government funds at property. Yan yung kaibahan ng responsibility at accountability. Therefore, si treasurer, accountable siya of accountability of local treasurer over government funds and properties. Ayan, i-highlight muna natin. Ano ba yung accountability ni local treasurer? Kasi ganina, nag-mention tayo ng responsibility of local treasurer over the supervision, answerability, di ba? So, ano ba yung accountability ni treasurer? Take charge of the diverse, take custody and exercise proper management of funds and take charge of the disbursement and so on and so forth. Ito, i-emphasize natin. Of such government funds and such other funds as the custody of which may be entrusted. Pag yung law nag-entrust sa kanya ng custody, ay accountable siya doon. So, balik pa rin tayo doon sa principle na pag accountable officer, hinahanapan yung actual custody at saka possession of government funds and properties. If your duty permits or requires you to possess or to take custody of government funds or property, you are accountable officer. O nagiging accountable officer si treasurer pag mayroong batas na nag-i-in-charge, nag-i-entrust sa kanya to take custody of such government funds and property. For example, this one. Yan, take custody. Yan kanina. Yan. Ito muna, accountability. Ito, amen. Mention ko ito. Pag walang GSO, yan, daming umaaray na treasurer dito. Ang dami pa naming trabaho. Bigyan pag gawin pa kaming property custodian. Yang pang last bullet ko. In case walang, ang LG walang general service officer, nagiging GSO si treasurer. And this time, nagiging accountable officer siya over this government property entrusted to her custody. Yan. That is an instance na nagiging accountable officer din si treasurer. Now, remember I have stressed, accountability is very different from responsibility because there are instances wherein the actual management of government funds and properties may be vested in another person. So while the agency head, for example, department head, pababaan natin, is merely responsible to take care that such resources are managed by those accountable officer through in accordance with the laws, rules, and regulations. So alam natin minsan, yung actual funds and custody, possession of actual funds, actual possession or custody of funds and property, wala sa'yo, nasa iba, siya yung accountable officer, baka ikaw responsible officer. So tanong loy natin last week, recap pa lang ito. Automatic pa pag na-identify ka na responsible officer, liable ka na. Or automatic pa na pag na-identify ka na accountable officer, liable ka na. First, of course, we will define liability. It is personal obligation that may be satisfied through payment or restitution. So itong liability na ito na sinasabi ng ating mga annual audit report are not necessarily administrative liability na yung mga penalty na dismissal, suspension, fine, and so on and so forth. Personal obligation pala ito that may be satisfied through payment or restitution that is meant by liability dito sa pinag-usapan natin. Wait, how about the measures of liability to accountable persons and responsible officers? Ayan, comment ha? Now, therefore, pag responsible officer ka, pag may responsibility, fiscal responsibility ka, your degree of failure to exercise diligence good of a good father of family in the supervision of those who are actually accountable for the government's funds and property. So, ibig sabihin, pag hindi ka nag-exercise ng diligence of a good father of family in supervising accountable officer, magiging liable ka rin. Tanong ko nga last week, sabi ko, what if ang nagka-shorted si collector, naggamit or ano, nawala, or na-rob doon sa collection, hindi pa na-deposit, hindi pa na-turnover, formally through a report of collections and deposit, RCD. So, yung accountability na andyan pa. Would you agree? Yung accountability na andyan pa kay collector, hindi pa na-ipasa yung accountability doon kay treasurer. Would you agree? So, comment dyan. So, if that is the case, na si collector pa yung accountable officer, would you impute responsibility over the local treasurer also? And perhaps liability later on? So, yan yung sabi natin. Pag si treasurer nag-exercise ng diligence of good father of family, for example, nag-issue na dapat mayroong memorandum si treasurer over his local collectors, sinasabi, deposit daily, or dapat ganito, i-safeguard nyo, ganito, ganyan. Or, for example, na just memo, nakakanda ng surprise audit si treasurer, pag-determine na hindi na nagamit ng mga collectors yung mga collection for the day, that perhaps may show diligent of good father family in supervising accountable officer. So baka naman hindi magiging liable in that case si treasurer. Baka naman, again, we will re-establish disclaimer natin. What we are discussing here are just generic principles, hindi necessarily applicable sa iyong case. Iba-iba pa rin yan. Nor is this the policy of the bureau. Okay. Yung responsibility ayan is to see to it that the properties are managed and utilized in accordance with the law and regulation. Okay. However, when it comes to accountabilities, pag si accountable officer, you remember sino si accountable officer? Si accountable officer siya yung merong actual possession and custody of government funds and property. Actual yung hinahanap natin para magiging accountable officer ka. If your duty requires to permit you to take custody or possession of government funds and property, you are therefore accountable officer. So what is the measure of liability? First, automatic yan, liable sa accountable officer pag mayroong unlawful deposit, unlawful use or application thereof. At pangalawa, pag yung loss ay attributable to negligence. Pag nawala yung funds and property due to negligence, liable si accountable officer. So what is negligence? Sabi nga natin, it is the want of care, pero hindi natin mag-intindihan yung definition niyan through that definition lang. So last week, we have visited one case study, yung sinasabi nga natin, yung case study natin na, ayan, hindi pa ako naka-spotlight, tingnan po natin. Ayan, balik na tayo ulit. Good morning. So, nahihirapan tayong define na negligence. So, we cited one case as an example kung saan yung isang government official mayroong government issued cell phone nag-attend nag-meeting na pickpocket na wala. Sabi ng Supreme Court, she was not negligent in riding the public transport, specifically LRT. Wala naman daw nagbabawal sa iyong sumakay ng LRT pag mayroong government-issued property sa iyo na cellphone. Again, this may not apply to specific cases na mayroong peculiarities. Basahin ko lang para hindi magkamali. So, ito yung sinasabi ng Supreme Court in that case that we have mentioned last week. Mayroong citation doon. Sabi ng Supreme Court dito sa GR number 143403, hindi ko lang sinite yung title baka kasi nationwide yung viewership natin, baka may nakakilala, so hindi lang natin mention. So therefore, the crucial question to ask during the time is, was the riding of the public transport, the LRT, is a negligent act on her part? No, sabi ng Supreme Court, the riding of the LRT cannot be denounced as a negligent act, more so under the circumstances in which case, si ma'am kasi, medyo mababa yung income niya doon sa salary grade niya. So, hindi daw ma-require na magsakay ng taxi or private vehicle for that matter. And possession of a cellular phone would not and should not hinder one from boarding an LRT. Ayan. So that's it for our recap for last week's episode. Ngayon, due to the interest of time, one case study lang muna yung ipapasada natin. So bago tayo magpapa-shoutout, bitiwan ko muna ito kung ano ba itong one case study natin for you to comment na rin. Standby muna ha. Ayan. Asan na ba yung case study muna? Standby muna na ha. Kailangan nating bitiwan muna natin yung case study for them to comment na rin dyan sa ating comment section kung ano yung masasabi nila tungkol dito ha. Hindi, I cannot find my shares na my case study pa rin. Ayan, nandito na. Okay, pasensya. Case study ha. Hindi pa rin. Stop share muna. Ako na lang ang magbasa sa case study for you to comment on our comment section ano yung masasabi niyo. Okay. This is a case of unliquidated cash advances, failure to render account. Nag-draw kasi ang isang municipality ng cash advance for the purpose yung in-enter sa JEV sa journal entry voucher. For the purpose daw of maintenance of economic enterprises and augmentation of general fund. Tapos dinisallow ng auditor kasi yung purpose daw is too vague. So sinong magiging liable? Si treasurer ba or ang mayor? Diba? Sila yung nakapirma doon. So again, cash advance, the purpose was augmentation of general fund. Dinisallow ng auditor kasi vague daw yung purpose na yan. So, sinong magiging liable? Comment naman dyan, si mayor o si treasurer? Ayan. At this juncture, ladies and gentlemen, papasadahan natin yung mga pa-shoutout. Ayan, nagka-copy pa yata. Nasarapan yata sa copy niya. Kapinoy. Cappuccino pa naman. Pa-shoutout naman dyan, Miss Juna Nabilia. Pasok na, ay! Sarap na sarap talaga.
Sarap ng kape.
Nag-smudge yung lipstick mo na eh. Nag-smudge.
Ah, paka ano. Sus, mabuti nila nakita talaga. Iba talaga itong kape na to.
Uy, may ganyan kayo. May pizza pa ha? Kape at saka pizza.
Pag uminom ka, Tony, kailangan sabayan ng ano pizza kasi masarap yung kape sa pizza.
Patikim naman yan. Sige na, go ahead.
Shout out po kay Lerio de los Reyes, Bantasan ng Sibunga, kay Yerim ng Compostela, kay Leticia Abs Cabilo ng Treasurer ng Dumanhog, kay Cesar Palma Sabas Jr., Oh, friend natin ito attorney si City ng City Assessor's Office ng Danao City.
Yeah.
Shout out din po kay Jen Formentera ng LGU Madridejos, kay Rene Hayag ng Paso Bohol, kay Grace Arpon ng Tabugon, Cebu, Hernan Suliano, top fan na po siya, kay Charito Espantalyon ng ang Municipal Assessor ng Dumanhog, kay Sid Caballero, kay Lucia Nylon, at saka may comment dito, sir. Kahit hindi nanalo si Miss Rabia sa Miss You, palagi tayong panalo kapag nanonood tayo sa Kapihan sa BLGF7. Panalo-panalo talaga ang Kapihan, ma-attorney. Shout-out pa rin. Isa pa rin pong malakas na shout-out kay Christina Mons ng San Francisco, kay Nisa Kompleto ng Balamban, kay Rose Marie Villacampa ng Lasi, kay Glenn Blair de Tlapinya ng Talibon, kay Bernadette Tubalya Obanyana ng Santa Catalina. At I would like to say hi to my mayor, Mayor of Tacoronc City, Mayor Angelo Roncal o Montilla. Sir, malapit na ang June. Okay.
Paano yan? Adi.
Words. Oh, ano yan? Iwan mo na yung ESRA ng Region 7, John?
Sinaningan na ako, sir, hanggang June. Kailangan mag-decide na ako.
Okay. Words. Shout out kay ano, kay Sir Dave Serrano, yung PAMAS President.
Good morning, Mr. He's President.
Watching. Sir President, Sir Dave, thank you for watching.
So, also, Sir Dave, Torns, nabasa ko po. Yeah.
Yes, yung president po ng PAREB, Philippine Association of Real Estate Board, Sir William Floresta is also watching. Thank you, Sir William, for joining online Kapihan sa BLGF7. Also, Torns, yung best friend ni ano ni Sir Edwin, si Miss Osang, Rosana Salvador.
Ah, Ma'am Osang. Okay.
Nanunood si Miss Osang.
Okay. Yes. From the central office.
Edwin is
Education sa loan borrowing capacity. Mm-hmm. So thank you, Ma'am Usang, for joining Kapihan. Thank you, Torns.
I have to give you this this portion of our program na medyo tagilid pa rin yung Region 7 in terms of our reportorial requirements. Sabi nga ng mantra ng ating executive director, we cannot manage what we cannot measure. So Ardi, manawagan ulit tayo, Ardi, na for the timely and accurate submission of our ESRA. Sana, Ardi, next time.
Yes, so the ESRA wizards in the regional offices will be monitoring closely yung compliance ng ESRA. So yung Region 7 is medyo hindi tayo nag-perform last year. So hopefully 2021 will be our reckoning time, okay? Para ibalik natin yung glory for Region 7. Yeah. So treasurers and assessors in Region 7, expect na sa kulit, sa follow-up from our regional focal persons, okay? So
Insindit na LRD kanina nag-awarding kasi yung central office sa mga very accurate and very early submission compliance of ESRA. Medyo nahiya tayo at hindi tayo na mention. Ganun pala yung feeling pag hindi tayo top performer.
Okay. Pero I understand, Torns. I don't give I just have bad feeling because alam ko sa in terms sa capacity, in terms sa ano sa mga people natin around, kayang-kaya natin. It's just that the attitude of doing it, di ba?
Yeah.
Yun lang ang kailangan i-develop lang. Pero in terms of competence, our treasurers, our vocal persons can do it, okay? It's just that we have to develop their mindset, we have to recreate their mindset kasi akala nila before we just do it on the deadline
lang.
Okay lang, hindi na deadline ngayon yung labanan.
Yes.
So yun na nga, we have set the criteria, the central office has set the criteria that it's not only that you prepare the report, it must be complete and accurate report. Okay? Timely, accurate, and complete report. So yun lang po, yun lang ang ano natin, drive natin, yung motivation natin that we have to do it. We have to do good for 2021.
Ayan. Thank you, Eddie. Ang kagayaan naman doon sa mga nag-effort talaga na mag-submit early at accurately. eh nadadrag down yung the whole region pag may miski isang LGU lang yung hindi nagpe-perform. Ayan.
We can do it, bawi tayo next year. We can do it, RD.
Yeah, bawi tayo next. Pakita natin na, kay nanay na before siya pupunta ng Takurong, eh, 100% yan even before, a month before the deadline. Ayan.
Lords, pagbigla, mag-agree tayo sa mga birthday celebrants natin for the week.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so we would like to greet a happy birthday, a happy birthday to our Municipal Treasurer Buslob Cebu, Ma'am Amelia B. Sabandal. Happy birthday, Ma'am, from your BLGF7 family. So, happy birthday po. Another birthday celebrant for this week, the acting Municipal Treasurer of Sambuanguita Negros Oriental, si Sir Paul Ray Ambrose A. Martinez. Okay. Na-interview pa lang namin para magiging full-fledged Municipal Treasurer ng Negros, Sambuanguita Negros Oriental. Happy birthday, Sir Paul. So, the rest, yung ibang birthday celebrant, okay, say happy birthday to all of you from your BLG.
Happy birthday, baka naman. May kape kami pero wala pa kami ng tanghalian. Baka naman. Ayan, happy birthday po, sir. Biro lang, baka totohanin nyo. Eh, kami po ay hindi tumatanggi sa mga lunch offer nyo. Ayan, okay. Dito na tayo sa first katanungan. Wala pa yata nag-comment. Okay, again, if had this been face-to-face, this would have been a workshop. Kasi ang hirap magsalita, ikaw lang. So, ayan, hindi ko pala naipakita. Sorry. Wala pa lang share screen. Okay, standby muna. Ayan, hinahanap ko pala yung case study ko. Sabi natin, magkuha 1 hour lang sana tayo nito. Eh, meron pa naman akong i-consulta na isa. Talagang importante din yun. Okay. Ayan, luloko na naman yung share screen namin dito. Ayan, finally, bumalik na agad siya. Okay. Now, yung nabitin nating katanungan kanina, again, we are still on responsibility, accountability, and liability. Huwag mo nang tumutok sa screen kasi nag-scroll down ako. Baka ma-vertigo kayo niyan. Hindi ko na-exit, baka hindi ako makapag-share screen. Okay, ito. Now, how about unliquidated cash advances and failure to render accounts? In this juncture, I'd like to ask you, sa unliquidated cash advances, sino yung responsible officer? Sino yung accountable officer? Now, imagine this scenario. This is an actual case, Supreme Court case. Again, hindi lang muna natin isa-cite yung citation kasi nationwide yung viewership, baka may nakakikilala sa subject ng ating case. First, where there was a cash advance amounting to a total of 1 million. Now, the purpose of the cash advance was... Yan, hindi na... Was, wag muna yung maintenance of economic enterprise. Parang okay yan. Ito, pwede bang purpose ito na cash advance? Augmentation of the general fund. I-augment daw yung general fund. So, nag-draw siya ng money para i-augment sa general fund. Oh, medyo mahirap yata yun. Parang, for example ha, this is me. Pag nagkaya kulang yung general fund ko, eh, draw ako sa sariling fund ko para lulubog ng yun ba yun? Eh, pati yung auditor na medyo nahirapang umintindi, ano ba yung ibig sabihin ng augmentation ng general fund na cash advance na yan? So thus, it was disallowed. And again, there was failure to indicate specific legal purpose. Parang napaka-generic daw yan ang augmentation. Vague daw yung augmentation of general fund. Now, the mayor argued that he was not liable of the cash advance because hindi naman daw siya yung gumamit ng cash advance na yon, ng 1 million na yon. In fact, sabi ng mayor, it is the municipal treasurer alone who have benefited the 1 million cash advance. Eh, nidraw ng 1 million, pinantapal, eh, forgive me for lack of better term, augmentation kasi yung ginamit ng Supreme Court, pinantapal doon sa general fund. May ganun ba? Again, sabi ng mayor, hindi ako ang nakinabang sa 1 million na yan, na cash advance na yan. Eh, dapat si treasurer ang magiging liable kasi siya naman yung nag-augment sa doon sa general fund. However, the charge was failure to render accounts. Yung hindi na-liquidate yung cash advance, eh, paano naman yung i-liquidate yung augmentation of general fund? Eh, any comment dyan? Paano ba i-liquidate yung augmentation of general fund? Medyo mahirap. So therefore, of the primordial interest in this case is whether or not si Mayor ba is an accountable public officer? Yan yung talagang itinanong ng Supreme Court, hindi responsible. Diba sabi ka natin kanina, eh, mga heads of agency sana, responsible officer, supervision. So if you are interested of the full facts and the decisions of the case, please visit the Supreme Court website, yung official website niya, and look for this GR number 171437 dated October 4, 2007. So madaliin natin yung pagpasada ng decision ng Supreme Court. Again, wag mo nang tititig sa screen, baka kasi magka-vertigo kasi kayo, kasi napakalakas ng ating plan. Natin isa-isahin yung facts kasi mag-11 naman. Now, dito muna. Ang tanong natin kanina, accountable ba si Mayor? Ang tanong natin, in short, liable ba si Mayor? Eh, walang tanong sa responsibility. Kayo kaya, sino yung responsible officer sana dito? Sino yung accountable officer sana dito? At sino yung magiging liable? Again, the heads of agency are primary liable for government funds pertaining to his agency. Responsible pala, primarily responsible. Sana, si head of agency is responsible officer over the funds. Pag sino yung may actual possession or custody, siya yung magiging accountable officer. Eh, sati dito. Alam nyo ba dito sa case na ito, nagiging accountable officer si Mayor? Bakit? Eh, sabi naman ni Mayor, hindi naman ako ang nakinabang, si treasurer naman yung nakinabang. Well, the problem is, during this, in this case, sabi ng Supreme Court, si Mayor kasi yung payee of the check, and it was him who received the check talaga. Diba sabi natin, ang accountable officer ay siya yung tao na mayroong actual possession or custody of the government funds or property. Eh, pag payee ka, ikaw yung mayroong actual possession of that funds. Ikaw kasi yung payee. Therefore, ikaw yung accountable officer. Pag ikaw yung accountable officer, ikaw yung mag-liquidate, ikaw yung mag-render accounts. So sabi ng Supreme Court, it was never denied that he received the check, and in fact, he was the payee. Say, Mayor daw yung payee. So ano man yung sabi niya, hindi naman ako nakinabang. Eh, si treasurer naman yung nakinabang. He is still considered accountable officer because by virtue of his being payee of the check, he now is in possession of or custody of the government funds and property, and being custodian, he becomes liable. It is his accountability to render accounts. Sabi ng Supreme Court, si Knight yan, he is undeniably an accountable officer, and therefore, as accountable officer, it is his obligation to liquidate the cash advances. However, considering that cash advances were disallowed, the petitioner this time, ang sinasabing petitioner, si Mayor yata ito, hindi si Treasurer, was born to render, to return the 1 million cash advance. Nakuha niyong isyo? Sino man yung gumamit ng pera na yan na kinash advance, but the fact is, payee ng checkee at saka siya yung nag-receive, siya yung nagiging accountable officer. Now, he could have compelled the treasurer to render the necessary accounting, or could have simply prepared, as accountable officer, could have simply prepared it itself. However, he neither did neither, and therefore, he just gave the excuse that medyo basic kasi siya. Therefore, yung Article 218 of the Revised Penal Code, failure to render an account, liable siya doon kasi it is just a matter of liquidating and rendering account after identifying that he was an accountable person. However, he has the right to recover the 1 million in which from persons who are solidarily liable with him. Again, the moral of the story, pag may pinakash advance sa iyo, hindi ko sinabing si Mayor ha, pag may kinakash advance sa iyo, tapos hindi naman ikaw yung makikinamang dyan, huwag kang magiging payee dyan. Lalo na kayo treasurer, pag may project pesta, ganito, ganyan, babayaran yung mga choreographer, kailangan ngayon, may mga props, may mga costume. Huwag kayong magpaye sa check kasi kayo yung mag-render accounts kasi magpaye, automatic ka naging accountable officer. Ayan, when we go back, we will cut this off sa responsibility, accountability, and liability. We will discuss Arias Doctrine. We will discuss yung mga membership of Bids and Awards Committee. Paano ba yan pag si treasurer member ng PAC? Tapos na disallow, liable ba siya doon sa mga dinilibrate doon sa back? Yan, pag-usapan natin in the next episode. Meanwhile, we have to cut off the topic on responsibility, accountability, and liability. And when I go back from the shoutouts of Ms. Jonan, pagbalik ko, pag-usapan natin yung e-consulta, dalawang e-consulta sana. Tignan natin kung kakayanan ng oras. In the meantime, papasadahan na naman natin yung nagkakape. Yung nagkakape, ayan. Pasadahan natin yung mga pa-shoutouts. Diyan na, ipasok.
Ikaw palabas po para kay Sinaida Ilan de Borja ng LGU Obando. I think this is from Obando, Bulacan.
Bulacan?
Obando, kasi Obando. Sa Bulacan yata yung Obando. Kay Geraldine Tabangay Tan ng El Nido, Palawan. Kay Bingbing Pontanosa. Kay Sara Mitante. Kay Jed Chin. Kay Alan Suaso, sigaw palabas pa rin para kay Carlito John Fajardo, kay Noel Enriquez, kay Julius Panoy. Isang pagkalakas-lakas na sigaw palabas para kay Rio Maria Josefina ng Toledo City, kay Cirilo Amazona ng Dalaget, kay Edsel Aguda ng San Fernando, kay Hunsoy ni Inku Iyas ng Bulhoon, kay Virgilia Rojo Ofone ng Sibunga, kay Glan Balasabas ng Tanhay Negros Oriental. Siya po yung municipal assessor ng Tanhay. Kay nawala
Glan na. Is asan si Glan? Si
kay Papa ni Julius Panoy. Kay Mr. Panoy si Mr. na nanonood doon sa Leyte. Palagi ko lang malilimutan, Julius, ang pangalan ng papa mo. Bigyan mo nga ako ng ano. Kasi makalimutin na ako. Umpisa nang nag-COVID na yan. Panoy, At saka kay Dave L. Serrano Jr., kay Lorelyn San Jose, Eugenia Montañez Dayan ng Sibunga, kay Julie Santos, kay Onisera Nadut, kay Sir Arsenio Podutan, ang Municipal Treasurer ng Albuquerque, Bohol. Kay Ruby Ann Antupina ng Toledo City, kay Eva Dillon ng Daan Bantayan, at kay Miss Osang Rosana E. Salvador. Osang. Isang shout out para po sa inyo lahat. Back to you, Torn.
Yeah, Adi, pa-shout out dyan, Adi. Baka may fans dyan nagpa-follow sa iyo. Pag-hit naman.
Yes, shout out pa rin sa mga members ng Cebuano Business Club, Group and Micro and Small Entrepreneurs in Cebu, they are watching us. So, kung pwede po yung mga nanonood, kindly message us in the message box so that we can recognize you, sino-sino po yung mga micro and small entrepreneurs in Cebu that are watching us towards. Thank you so much.
Ayan, sorry. Okay. Thank you, Adi. Ayan, ito. I-shout out ko rin yung aming Deputy Executive Director, si Engineer si Arnold Tan, RD. Regularly watching us on our Kapian, RD.
Yes, talagang request niya itong online ipapadiscuss talaga ni Deputy Executive Director Arnie Tan kay Attorney Tanika para mas malaman. ng mga viewers natin, ng mga treasurers, yung assessors, yung policies about this one. Sige, Toys.
Yeah. Okay. We are working on something kasi we are not in authority to divulge ano yan, nor am I speaking in behalf of the group sa tinatrabaho namin. Basta we are working on something together with RD and of course si Boss Arnie, focus group discussion, and this is has been going on for several months already, weeks at the most. So ito yung pinapabigyang emphasis ng ating Deputy Executive Director Engineer Tan. I-discuss daw natin ito sa Kapian. So I will consider this as an e-consulta. You know, our regional director earlier of this episode sa ating Kapihan has mentioned the vacuum in our municipal assessor's offices. Ang daming vacuum, lalo na dyan sa Bohol. So ang ginagawa minsan ng iba, nag-designate lang ng municipal treasurer. Treasurer, assessor. Yan, during our deliberation of that something that we are working, again, I am not an authority to divulge ano yung ginagawa namin, nor am I speaking in behalf of the group. So therefore, this is a preliminary discussion. Yes, Ardi, go ahead, Ardi.
It's not only in Bohol, pero marami din tayo sa Cebu who are designated as assessor. Okay, so walang full-fledged assessor. So might as well, in Region 7 alone, napakarami pong acting assessor. So sila po yung subject na i-discuss ni Attorney Tanyika. Kaya para mas maliwanagan. Okay? So regarding the appointment and designations. Sige, Torch.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Adi. Okay. Pasensya, hindi ko mapalakihan yung screen ko kasi may problem with hindi mag-resume. Okay. Now, you know, as I said, ang daming designation due to the vacuums in our office, sa municipal assessor's office. But you have to remember, there are civil service rules governing these matters about designation. Of course, prior to this aura-aura na government service, civil service resolution, mayroon yung mga designee, kailangan pa rin ng minimum requirements. So kung ano yung minimum requirements, dapat din ma-meet. But now, we have centered in on this provision, 1613C, 6 of the Civil Service Resolution, or the Omnibus Rules on Appointments and Other Human Resources Actions, or the ORA-ORA. Ayan. I hope you can see my screen. Hindi siya medyo mapalakihan ko. Ayan. Yan yung resolution dated July 3, 2018. So dito, naka-define kung ano yung designation. Dito ko rin nalaman ano yung pagkakaiba ng acting na designation at saka OIC. So more or less, si OIC is just to hold the forts. Limited lang yung powers niya, ensuring that the office continues its usual activity. Si acting pala, not only exercise ministerial function, but also exercise discretion. So parang mag-decide na rin attached to the position, but also exercise this discretion since the person designated as acting is deemed to be incumbent in the position. Yun yung kaiba. Now, as to the requirement, again, hindi ko mapalaki masyado, but i-zoom in ko yan later on. Yan yung mga requirements, 1, 2, 3, 4. Hanggang 8 yan. Now, sabi kasi natin, sir, ano paano ba yan, sir? Ang daming dinidesignate sa na municipal assessor kasi nga walang licensed real estate appraiser. Again, we emphasis on appraiser. May issue kasi tayo doon sa service. So, paano ba yan, sir? Can we designate just anybody? Now, the answer is this. The Memorandum of the Civil Service doon sa Section 13C, item number 6C, doon sa ORA-ORA, sabi noon. Employees designated should also hold permanent appointments to career position. Ito, hindi ka makapag-designate ng municipal assessor pag casual job order or contractual or miski mga consultancy lang. Kasi dapat mayroong accountability tayo doon sa mga nakaupong municipal assessor. So kailangan siya hold permanent position doon sa LGU na kinalalagyan niya. Number 2, designees can only be designated to positions with their level that they are currently occupying equal, and designation should be made through an office order. Huwag yung sabi-sabi lang, yung verbal lang. It should be through an office order. Sino magdi-designate? Eh, yung appointing officer doon sa LGU, yung appointing officer, si mayor naman. Diba si mayor yung magagawa ng order designating the function. Remember, si mayor din yung magiging mag-unda lookout kung sino yung linagay niya doon. Kasi hindi basta-basta kung si mayor nag-order ng kung sino yung nailagay ng as designee, hindi basta-basta kung sino-sino lang yung mailagay. Bakit? Eh, sabi natin, sir, yung designation na yan, hindi na yan naman yan dumadaan doon sa civil service, kaya hindi nakikita yung mga license ba siya or hindi. No, according to the civil service resolution ng URA-URA, dito sa provision ng section 13, for designations to critical possessions like the department heads, kalakip na yan yung assessor, municipal assessor is a department head, the office order ni mayor shall be furnished to by the RMOs of the LGUs to the civil service field office. Titingnan pala yan ng civil service field office. So, ito, miski hindi dumadaan yung mga designations, tinitingnan within 30 days upon its issuance. At ito yung crucial. Employees designated to the position with duties involving practice of a profession. Remember, real estate appraiser is a profession. Yeah? Shall be requirement na pala ngayon through this URA-URA to possess that necessary professional license. Eh, alam natin sa Real Estate Service Act, rini-require yung real estate appraiser na license before you can engage into the practice of appraisal. Eh, it goes without saying, requirement na rin yan, even in designation. Again, minimum requirement in designation, kailangan ma-meet mo. And pangalawa, kailangan mong magkaroon din ng license to be designated for that. Adi, this goes without saying yung sabi natin, you cannot engage in the practice of appraisal or appear to be engaged in the practice of appraisal pag wala kang license, adi? As a Risa din yan, adi?
Yes, that's right. So, the law is very clear. So, kasi ang issue doon towards, right, me personally, I raise it na yung designation naman hindi dumaan, hindi dadaan sa civil service. And it is good that Director Tan pointed out that URA-URA pala that the HRMO of every LGU should furnish a copy to the civil service all designation issued to per LGUs. Tama, Torch? Pero ang tanong ko lang, Torch, may power ba si civil service to invalidate the designation orders made by the LCEs?
Yeah. If we go by the resolution, ari, klarong-klaro kasi doon na the designation possess the minimum requirement, yung pagiging license. So I guess along that line, si civil service makakall ng attention doon sa isang LGU na you are violating the URA-URA. Requirement kasi ng URA na should possess the license. Pag yung department head daw, being department head, is an exercise of a profession. Alam natin yung assessor, exercise ng profession na yan. Kailangan na yung license. Eh, that is civil service resolution kasi. So, pag nakita ng civil service yung designation ni mayor, siguro i-call yung attention ade.
So to make things clear, appointment, whether appointment or designation, it requires one to be a real estate appraiser. Otherwise, meron po tayong nababiolate na rules or law. Tama po, Torx?
Yes. Yes, Ardy. Again, we are quoting the Section 13C of URA-URA. Employees designated to possessions with duties involving practice of profession shall be required. Requirement yan. So siguro, i-call lang attention sa civil service. Mr. Mayor, may license ba yan yung dinidesignate mo? Kasi this is a requirement under this. Isasite muli natin yung civil service rules kasi sila yung... ito. Section 13C, item number 6 of the Civil Service Resolution number 1800-6952 or the URA-URA. Again, thank you, Deputy
Executive Director. Yes, ano po lang? So, kasi back naman, once may invalidate ang civil service yung designation or appointment, there might be a problem that might come out,
hey, Mayor.
Especially those who are signing the documents or the appraisal report or the appraiser assessment documents. So to do away with that, so please let us comply.
Yeah. Again, Ardy, you have to stress na under RESA, yung Real Estate Service Act, you cannot engage into a practice without a license yung appearing to exercise the function of an appraiser, may provision talaga doon.
Mm-hmm. Tending to show, like you are tending to show, yeah. By just signing with your designation, using the term OIC assessor, you are deemed practicing profession by tending to show that you are an appraiser by because using that designation.
But without license, yan violation din
yes,
ng RISA.
Yes, you might get trouble with that because nasa provision ng batas ng RA 9646 wherein any person tending to show that he is one.
Okay? Oh, words to that effect, parang
yet,
ganun,
no? Diba? So still, if you are designated as OIC assessor, meron pa rin yung pwede ka pa rin habla later on kasi you are tending to show that you are a prisoner since you were designated as assessor. Alright, yes, sige. Yes. Thank you, Torch.
Again, we have DPT Executive Director Jose Arnold Tan, Engineer Tan, to thank for this provision. Ayan,
Deputy Executive Director Arnie Tan.
I would like to talk about yung mga where our policy makers are going in terms of the Reform Act, yung mga valuation form, kasi ang dami sanang gagawin before the pandemic na yung VRA supposedly. So ang daming alam ni Deputy Executive Director Tan tungkol dyan, isa yung palaging ini-invite ng mga congressional hearings. So where are we going after this during this pandemic? So ano yung nakabinbin natin, paano na yung mga practice of the profession? Yun Adi, so hopefully Adi, magparamdam tayo Adi na Sir Tan, ikaw, do the honors Adi, na hopefully someday if available Adi.
Especially towards that the PRB res is have a lot of innovations also introduced. So Director Arnie Tan is not
the
just
commissioner of the PRB res.
Director, he is also a member of the Professional Real Estate Service Board. So we have a lot of topics to throw to him. We have a lot of questions.
Yeah, yeah.
So most likely we can, with your indulgence, Torch, we can arrange for an episode with Director Arnie.
Yes, Ardy. Yeah. We can talk with them siguro sa ating regular focus group discussion. Again, this is not we are not in authority to divulge ano yung focus group discussion namin ni Ardy with the Ititan. Yeah. Thank you, Ardy. Hopefully magkatotoo. Kasi ang daming issues din natin sa valuation. Okay. Now, go back, balik tayo doon. Medyo napalalim yung discussion. May isang i-consulta pa ako. Go back tayo doon sa mga pa-shoutouts na ipasadahan.
Shout out kay Ray Caluoy of Kapinoy Coffee. Isang shout out pa rin kay Ernesto Rupac, kay Brenda Llamedo, kay Ronnie Ferriol ng BPLO Masbate City, kay Annabel Enriquez, kay Tita Barcina Ruiz, kay Ebs Rosas, kay Sinaida Lian de Borja ng LGU Ubando, Geraldine Tabangay Tanan Tan ng El Nido, kay Miguel Magan, ang Municipal Assessor ng Danao, Bohol,
Sir Mike,
kay ID May, Pasente Electona, na ang Municipal Assessor ng Santa Catalina ni Grosor. Uy, ang daming assessor na nanonood ngayon. Kay Virginia Huaton, kay Clarence Bello Gumba ng LGU Gamay Northern Samar, kay Arlene Chari Puntines ng Amlan Negros Oriental, kay Charlene Laganti ng from Municipal Assessor's Office LGU Buhi Camarines Sur to Region 5. Ang dami pa lang nanonood ngayon ng mga assessors attorney. Tamang-tama sa topic nyo.
Naandyan kasi yung president nila, si Mr. Dave Serrano. Good morning, sir.
Shout out kay Mr. Dave Serrano, sir. Magandang umaga po sa inyo. Okay, Torns.
Na muna, Nay?
Shout out pa rin kay Lorelyn San Jose, kay Eugenia Montanes Dayag ng Sibunga, Julie Santos, Oy Nesra Natodof. Pero binaliktad niya lang to. Si Arton, ano to? Si Arsenio Pudutan ng Municipal Assessor.
Former President of Bumontreal, si Sir Pudutan.
Former President ng Bumontreal, ngayon si Mr. Perdo. Castrodes.
Puerto Castrodes.
Okay, that's right. Back to you.
Good morning sa lahat-lahat. Especially good morning to Engineer Glenn Balasabas ng Tayasan, hindi Tanay. Tayasan. Kay Assessor Cesar Sabas ng Danao City at saka sa treasurer natin dito sa Danao City si Glorna Dagatan Morales. Morales Dagatan ba? Ayan, ito isang panghuling ikonsulta natin for this episode. Nakalimutan ko yung tanong nito, yung kailan ba daw magkapag-collect na 10 years at saka 5 years ready, spinify ni ma'am kung anong issue yung ibig niyang ipa-discuss. I just followed yung sa comment ni ma'am Lucille doon sa San Juan, Siquijor. So susundan ko na lang yung comment ni ma'am Lucille about 10 years at saka 5 years. Kalimutan ko yung nagtanong sa i-consulta natin ito. Pangalawang i-consulta natin for this episode, number 10 years at saka 5 years. 10 years back taxes at saka 5 years prescriptive period. Ayan, hindi ko mapalagyan. Prescriptive talaga. Ayan. Now, we have discussed this in our prior episodes earlier. So, yung 10 years back taxes is only for properties declared for the first time, initial assessment declared for the first time. Now, emphasis sa section 222, ang gamitin nyo pag declared for the first time, real property taxation yung pinag-usapan natin. Usually, yung mga 10 years back taxes involves binding, usually lang ha, kasi mahirap naman yata pag ngayon ka palang nakapag-declare ng mga lupa for the first time. So yung back taxes na yan applies only for those properties declared for the first time. Hindi ka makapag-back tax pag mayroong prior appraisal and assessment na siya, pag mayroong prior declaration na siya. Na kasaad talaga sa batas, section 222 declared for the first time, magamit mo itong 10 years prior back. Now, in-expand ito, sinasabi, it should be computed. Kasi, what if 10 years, may tatlong SMB revision na. So, ang gagamitin na SMB revision, yung SMB applicable during that corresponding period. Pag magtatlong SMB doon sa 10 years span, yung SMB nung una, yung SMB pangalawa, so hindi isang SMB lang gagamitin. Iba, ibang value doon sa 10 years. So 10 years plus 1, nagiging 11 kasi ngayon, taxable ang ngayong years. Diba? So 10 years back, 10 years taxable, plus itong year na ito, assessment po, 11 years na yon. Okay. Now, however, what if sa building ito, Section 222, understandably, that talks about lupa. Kasi okay lang yan. Tumawid siya ng iba't ibang SMB, Schedule of Market Value. What if sa building, sir? In-expound din yan ng ating Local Assessment Regulation 1-92. Pag may back taxes sa building, pag sa land, computed in the force, in the basis of the SMB in force during that time. However, pag undeclared buildings and other improvements, hindi kalakip yung rule na yon. So, anong rule na yon? Ha? Shall be based, apply lang daw yung rule na yon na shall be based on the effective or corresponding SMB during that period. Apply lang daw yon sa land. Sa building, hindi daw yon mag-apply. So, anong sabi niya? Sabi ng LAR 1-92, kasi yung building and other structures or the machineries depreciate by the passage of time. And that depreciation may be physical, functional, or economic. May naigdagdag pa doon sa focus group discussion ni Director Tan. Sabi niya, mayroon pang environmental factor doon sa depreciation. Madaling mag-depreciate pag nasa tabi ng vulkan ka, tabi ng dagat, and so on and so forth. Now, this estimating depreciation for every period is an impossible task. Depreciation does not operate uniformly and regularly in that class property and the amount of depreciation accumulates from year to year. Therefore, sabi ng LAR 1-92, due to obvious difficulty in estimating the amount of depreciation undeclared and assessed buildings ito ha, and other structures and machinery subject to back taxes shall be classified and valued in accordance with the schedule of base unit construction cost in use or replacement of machinery. Basta in use. So, hindi na tatawid sa iba't ibang SMB. Pag buildings, kung ano yung current SMB na applicable, yan yung subject doon sa 10 years back. Kasi difficult to estimate the depreciation daw. Magkaiba. Tinanong ako ng isang assessor. Coming from Kuan. Hindi ba yan expounding kung ano yung sa batas? Sabi kasi sa batas, eh, kung ano yung operative during the 10-year period, dito sa laruan nito, in use daw. Eh, sir, ini-explain na natin, it is due to the obvious difficulty in applying depreciation. Kaya, through the power of the Secretary of Finance to promulgate rules and regulations para mayroong uniformity. Now, ito. About the 5-year period, naitakol na din yan natin dito sa ating kapihan. I forgot the episode, but it was the ask from by Miss Gina R. David, the Secretary Treasurer of Ligao. So, yung prescriptive period, 270, within which to collect taxes pag sumobra ng 5-year period, hindi na daw, prescribed na daw yan. But in expound yan, I have heard, if I understand it right, magkakaroon ng policy issuance dito. But in the meantime, may mayroong mga bill, GF opinion, expound is sinasabi na yung 5-year prescriptive period daw yan is to compare the treasurers to collect real property tax for the benefit, ito, for the benefit of the taxing authority. The prescriptive period were provided to enforce the collection and therefore, no action should be done by the treasurer. Ang ibig sabihin ng action, judicial or administrative action after the lapse of the 5-year period. Now, it is clarified. Pag nag-send si treasurer ng notices of delinquency or reminder letters, hindi daw yun nagsisit in yung 5-year period for the payment of real property tax, delinquent tax preparatory to the application of administrative and judicial remedies. Circumvention by non-payment, it is only when the treasurer neglected or deliberately failed to perform his duties giving rise to the prescription. Again, emphasis, pag nag-send siya ng notice of delinquency or letter of reminders, hindi daw pasok doon sa 5-year prescriptive period. It is only pag neglect si treasurer or deliberately failed to perform his duty to send those mga delinquency letters and letters of reminders. Otherwise daw, the taxpayers may circumvent the law by not just paying the taxes and just wait for the lapse of the 5-year prescriptive period. That's it for the 2E Consulta for today's episode. And before we end our episode 26, again, ipapromise ko sa iyo, tatapusin natin itong responsibility, accountability, and liability for 2 succeeding episodes lang. Hindi kasi dapat mamalitin para ma-digest that. In the meantime, huling pa-shoutouts at sigaw palabas sa ating mga viewers, we'll go back to our Chief of Treasury Division. Pasok na eh.
Bago muna tayo pa-shoutout, may comment si Ma'am Sinaida Ilan de Borja ng LGU Obando. Sabi niya, assessors in OIC position cannot approve the certified documents, especially the tax declaration. Only those with license can approve this documents.
Yan ang, well said, ma'am. Well said.
So, patuloy po tayo sa shout out kay Lisa Maiti Anoos, ang focal person ng Maria Siquijor, kay Intes Julina ng Toledo City, kay Maria Rosalyn Cudilla, kay Brenda Liamedo, kay Miguel Maban, kay Merisit Caballero, kay Arlene Chari Puntenis, kay Charlene Lagante, Virginia Huaton, at saka ID May Pasinti Ilictuna.
Hi, thank you, Nay. Thank you. At saka shout out kay Miss Rabia Mateo, ang representative ng Philippines sa Miss Universe. RD, ito na. Overtime tayo ng konti. Closing message mo, RD. Go ahead, RD.
Yes, sir. So, again, I'm so thankful to our production team headed by Attorney Tanyeka, Julius, Jun-An, and the rest of the team. Thank you for making our Kapihan very informative and lively as possible. Although, Torns, thank you also to our viewers, ha? Our 60 viewers na our, akala ko, yung problem natin today will be the engagement kasi ang kalaban natin, the Miss Universe. So, thank God that we still have 60 viewers.
Halos na kay Miss Jona Nabilia.
Oo. Lumipat nung hindi na nakapasok sa top 20 or top 10 si Rabia. Lumipat yung mga viewers to online kapihan. Okay. So again, thank you so much, our team, headed by Attorney Tanika, really prepared that we can present a relevant, interactive content. Okay. Because you are so special to us, we continually employ new techniques and technology to keep constant track of learning engagement to our treasurers and assessors. So to all of you, thank you for joining us and see you next episode.
Yan. And this has been the 26th episode of BLGF 7 Online Kapihan. Ikonsulta mo kay Tor Tanika. We'll have a third part of our responsibility, accountability, and liability next Monday. In behalf of the production team, in behalf of all the staff of BLGF 7, in behalf of all local treasurers and assessors of Region 7, this has been your host, Attorney Wilbert P. Tanika, saying bye-bye!